Hello. Hi, Caldran. Good to see you on.
Second. Hey, no, Professor.
Doing good. Doing good. How are things in your life?
They're going well. In the process of writing a proposal, to be sent to Italy for the summer, next summer. So I'm in the process of doing that. And
What kind of a proposal?
really just proposal, justifying how the research done in Italy, with NATO will be kind of beneficial for me and my facility here in
Oh,
Mississippi.
excellent. If you want another set of eyes on it, you're welcome to send it to me. I can give you some feedback. I don't know. I mean, do what you
Yeah,
will, but if you're interested in that, I'm happy to help.
sir, I can send you what I have and logistics of it and then kind of let you touch on it and probably go from there. Because I don't have anyone else looking at it right now. Because I
Oh,
kind of,
okay. It always helps. It always helps.
yeah.
Have you used any AIs before, like ChatGPT or anything like that? Do you know what I'm talking about?
I know what it is. It came to prominence when I was a senior in college, but no, not really. I've never.
Yes. So in the last year, it's really taken off. These are these generative AIs that have been trained on like the whole internet. They're pretty amazing in what they're capable of. And it's actually kind of scary when you see what they can do because you can see the capability to disrupt a lot of jobs. Like,
Yeah.
I had it write out a whole website, I had it write out advertisements for the program, and they look professionally done. And it took it all of like a minute, not
It's
even.
really crazy.
You can give it a PDF. And it'll read the PDF and summarize, and then you can ask it questions about the PDF.
I did not know of his capabilities.
You could, I mean, it can be misused. Like one of the things we're worried about in college is you can write, oh, have it write a whole paper for you.
Yeah, I think
Right?
that was
Like,
one. Yeah.
and it's hard to tell it wasn't written by a person.
Exactly.
The only reason I bring it up is because, you know, we've had a lot of discussions here on campus about it. And I really have the feeling that those who don't start using it and use it in the future are going to be left behind because of the people that are using it. And it's almost like you'll be at a disadvantage if you aren't at least trying to experiment with what it can do and how it can help you. What I'm trying to experiment with a lot in my classes right now is to try and use the AI to help learning. So, in other words, you can ask it about a topic, you know, and I don't understand this. Can you explain it? Can you break it down simpler? That kind of thing. And, you know, it's about when you're talking about science and stuff, maybe it's about 85% accurate. But for a lot of stuff, that can still be helpful. I mean, it's not something you want to cite. You want to check your facts, but I highly suggest you check it out. It's called ChatGPT. It's at openai.com. And you have to create your own account. It's free. There's a paid version where you, if a lot of people are using it, if you're not paying for it, then it might tell you to come back later, which is fine for most folks. But it's something I do suggest checking out. If you watch TikToks or YouTubes, I'd put in ChatGPT just in your search to get it in your feed because there's lots of examples coming out all the time of how it can be used and stuff. And I want to let everybody know to take a look. I'm not sure how I want to use it this course or future courses, but take a look at it. I mean, it can do anything from you tell it what's in your refrigerator, it'll tell you what recipes you can make, and give you step-by-step directions to, you know, you're doing work on a car, you've got this project, you want it to help you plan it out. You just, you can even tell it, you can even say, okay, this is what my goals are. This is what my project is. Ask me questions one at a time that will allow you to figure out how to help me. And then it will ask you questions and then you answer them. And then when it's done asking you the questions, it synthesizes that and gives you suggestions and plans things out. It's writes emails for you. It's crazy. Yeah.
Something to think about. Capabilities. Yeah.
Yeah.
I want to check it out.
Hi, Glory. How are you? Good to see you. So I did midterm grades. Guess what? A's. You both got A's in the class so far. So that is awesome. You guys are doing very well. I'm very, very happy with that. How do you like doing the Flipgrids and the peer teachings, the recording and then getting the recording back?
I enjoy them. You can probably still tell I'm still kind of getting used to it in a way. Yeah, I'm still kind of getting used to it with editing and trimming different parts of the video. Just kind of get, you know, fit into 5-minute increments because I do see myself talking over the 5-minute mark. So I'm still kind of getting used to that. But as a whole, I enjoy it.
And I can extend the times too, depending on the topic. I think having to explain something, you have to think about it better and learn it better if you want to be able to explain it to someone. And so that's what I think is the power of those things. So congratulations on your grades. I'm going to get started now that at least we got a few folks here. Hello, Mungo. Let me go ahead and share my screen. And pull this up. So we are in chapter 9 now of our textbook. If somebody has a PDF of it, I don't know what you guys are working on for the textbook, but if you've got a simple PDF, if you wouldn't mind sending me a copy, that would be awesome. It might be easier for me to grab some figures. How are you accessing the book, Glory?
It's okay, Prof. Reading it through my phone is all right.
Okay. How about you, Caldrin? Are you using a PDF or using like a downloaded software to read it?
It's a downloaded software.
Okay, fair enough. So we're going to, so we've talked so far to bring us up to speed. We've talked about the fact that we see warming. We've talked about the physics of warming itself and the theoretical basis for how addition of greenhouse gases could cause additional warming. We've looked at the climate records to show indeed we do see a lot of warming, and then additional evidence which confirms the warming, like melting of ice and ocean acidification, etc., sea level rise. Then we looked at a bunch of different possible contributors to climate change, and we ruled just about all of them out except for addition of greenhouse gases through the burning of fossil fuels. And then we started talking about, okay, well, if that's the case, if you add additional greenhouse gases, what does that do? We talked about radiative forcing and climate sensitivity, how an addition of a little bit of CO2, there are actual feedback effects which can amplify the effect on temperature, and additional CO2 being released into the atmosphere. And from there, we said, okay, well, since we know these emissions are caused by human activity, mostly economic activity, last time we started talking about various ways to predict what future greenhouse gases might look like. And we use the IPAT relation to kind of get a handle on how we might quantify human activity and its contribution of CO2 in the atmosphere. And then from there, you know, we compared that to the historical record of the last 60 years, where we have a lot of data on all of these things. And we looked at GDP and all the things in the IPAT relationship and saw that that relationship tracks pretty well the last 60 years. And so folks at ICCP, IPCC, had come up with some scenarios about predictions about the future based on different choices we might make. And so we saw these, we discussed these four scenarios. One is where this first one, SSP1, where we basically decide to stop adding any more CO2 in the atmosphere right now. And so we immediately switch to renewable energy sources and cut down on our CO2 emissions. So that line is shown in this blue. In this yellow, that's kind of that scenario, SSP2, is primarily based on the recent historical trends. If we keep along those trends right now, assuming we'd really cut our emissions somewhere around 2050, that gives us the SSP2. SSP3, however, and SSP5 are a little bit more dire. SSP5 is a world where there's lots of income equality, and that income equality leads to all sorts of bad things, right? So we've talked about these four different ones. And so we're talking about the future of climate change to see it where it can lead us. Some of the conclusions we found when we piped those IPAT relations into some of our climate models was looking at temperature. Pretty much our temperature change between now and 2040 is pretty much baked into the pudding. Regardless, whatever choices we make now, we're still going to see about an additional degree Celsius of warming. And then after 2040, 2050, then we'll start seeing the effects of changes that we make today. And those are the differences between those different scenarios. Okay. So I want to stand back and take a broader picture just to give an idea of what these things are. Like, we might not think that, okay, well, we've had 1 degree of warming so far. We'll definitely get another degree of warming. That's 2 degrees of warming. You know, that doesn't seem like a lot, right? It's just 2 degrees. If I went outside and it was room temperature, like 22 degrees Celsius, and I went outside and it was 24, big whip, no big deal, right? But what one has to remember is that these are global averages, right? And so extremes of weather, extreme high and extreme low, tend to cancel each other out a lot. And so the anomaly, when you look globally, tends to be very, very small. You know, the warming we could see, you know, in the worst scenario, by the end of the century, could be around 5 degrees Celsius. That is a huge amount. Even 3 degrees would be a pretty above pre-industrial levels. It'd be pretty intense. And so why do I say that's going to be intense? Well, let's look at the historical record. So you've seen this map before. This is the temperature anomaly, and pretty much up until today, that's in blue. Okay, this part here, that's our more recent temperatures. This red over here, this is the prediction for going up at 2100. And if you can see, the total temperature rise anomaly is about 3 degrees. And so that's SSP2. And so it's based on current historical trends, kind of the way we're going right now. Again, assuming that there isn't a permafrost feedback that's sufficient to worry about right now. So by 2100, we should see a three degree bump in temperature anomaly. Okay. That's this amount here. If you compare that to the difference between, so this is the interglacial period, here's the last ice age. If you look at the last ice age, it's about the same. I mean, these two arrows are almost essentially the same. And so that's kind of scary because the world looked, and so this is with a 4 degree temperature change. Okay, a 4 degree temperature change, that's it. And this is what the world looked like back then. I mean, entire continents were covered in ice sheets, glaciers hundreds of feet tall. The sea level was drastically different, 300 feet lower because of all this accumulation of the water in the form of ice and snow on top of the continents. Okay. And so there's a big difference in the way the last, our previous world looked 4 degrees Celsius ago. And now imagine we're going to go another 4 degrees in a warmer temperature. So the world that we would expect to see in 2100 will likely look very, very, very different than the world that we see now. Just as much. I mean, the difference should be just as much between now and the last 4 degree temperature rise. But that's not the only concern. The concern also is the time periods, the quickness at which this is changing. So the last ice age, it took us about 10,000 years to get out of the last ice age up to the current interglacial. Okay, 10,000 years, that means, and with a 4 degree temperature rise, that means you're talking about a few hundredths of a degree temperature change per century, right? Every 100 years, it's just a little bit. So after 10,000 years, you've changed by 4 degrees only. In the case of modern climate change, we're talking about a 4 degree change in just 100 years or in about 200 years. So the speed of these things are incredibly fast. Okay. Evolution and adaptation through evolution occurs, you know, with every generation, you know, having small mutations that over time give a species a slight advantage and allow those with that beneficial mutation to outpace its compatriots when it comes to reproduction. And so the distribution of that gene that's beneficial over time becomes more prevalent, right? But that's over lots of times, usually thousands of years, many, many generations. Here, we don't get that luxury for adaptation. So I want you to keep in mind the speed of change. There's a quote by one of our politicians, Marco Rubio. He said, yeah, sure, the climate is changing. The climate's always been changing. There's never been a time where climate hasn't changed. You know, we had ice ages. We had all the, you know, it was hot during the dinosaurs. Climate changes all the time. Yes, but we've never seen this rapid of a climate change. And humans have never lived through anything like this, nor has any other species on the planet. That's not to say that such a drastic change hasn't happened in the past. There have been five major extinction events since life first evolved on our planet. I really suggest y'all get to know some of them. I sent out a link to a movie, Animal Apocalypse, The Great Dying. Did anybody get a chance to watch it? I'm just curious.
Prof, I couldn't access it.
Oh, you couldn't access it. Oh, that's fun. Yeah, Caldrin, did you see it? What did you think?
I got like in the class before you sent out the link. I was familiar with some of them, but I didn't know the logistics or the extent of what happened. And I like how I kind of gave a play by play of the climate after the extinction and things like that, and kind of what the organisms on the and species on the earth kind of was going through at the time. I kind of like how I did it, kind of like play by play with each extinction event.
Yeah, and I'd like to reference the Permian extinction because that happened relatively fast, although I believe those volcanoes were going for about 10,000 years, pumping in that stuff in the atmosphere. So again, that was just even much slower than what we're experiencing now. Okay, so bear these things in mind, the speed, and life having to adapt, because the topic that I wanted to cover today is really the current effects of climate change, what we're seeing now. We got an idea how much they can change in the future, how much they're definitely going to change by 2100, but how are they changing now? And one of the principles that's important to understand is that, you know, climate change is going to cause a lot of damage, okay? But the damage from climate change isn't linear, okay? It's what we call a threshold phenomenon. So if you can imagine living in a house, the house is not too far from a river, okay? And so here's the house, here's the river, here's the level of the water in the river, okay? And sometimes it rains and the level of the river gets higher. And we know that with climate change, we expect the weather to get more extreme. We know that with higher temperatures in the atmosphere, a warmer atmosphere can absorb more water vapor. We talked, I think there was one lecture where we talked for how many grams a liter of air at room temperature can hold of water vapor versus one that's 10 degrees warmer or 5 degrees warmer. I forget which one we used, but there's definitely a significant difference between the two. And so when there's a rain event, you would expect with more water vapor in the atmosphere for that rain event to be more extreme. Well, each one of these rains, you know, the level of the river goes up and down and up and down. We don't notice. I'll just be happy sitting at home reading my book or getting ready for my next class. But with more additional rain, with more extreme weather, once it goes over the side, when the water level rises to get higher than the sides of the river, then we'll see flooding. Okay. And with flooding, you're going to get property damage. You may have to rebuild a lot of structure. It's chaos. It stops work. It stops a lot of human activity. And it can be quite tragic. It's one of these threshold events where everything seems fine until you get over a certain level, and then all of a sudden it becomes catastrophic. But up until that point, it was perfectly okay. So long as the water was below that line, it didn't matter. And so climate change is like that way. A lot of damage from climate change has this non-linear type of plot to it. So if you look at intensity of rainfall and the damage from that rainfall, you know, the first 80% of this rainfall did no damage whatsoever. It's not until it reaches a threshold level, like causing the water to overflow the riverbank, that you're then going to see damage. And then, you know, 90% of the damage or 100% of the damage is going to come after the threshold is met. So even if you're only adding on 20% of additional rainfall, that's where 100% of the damage is coming from, that additional percentage. So when we talk about increased percentages of precipitation, remember that that's after all the rest of the rain has already fallen. Okay. And so that's that we know that increasing heavy precipitation caused damage. and increasing rainfall by 10% will probably increase the damage from the rainfall by a lot more than 10% once you're past that threshold. Okay. And as always, when you get this kind of damage, the economy is going to take a hit from these events, right? It's going to make us all poorer when these things happen, because where does the money for rebuilding come from? It comes out of people's livelihoods. It comes out of whatever financial reserves the local economy has. That's where it comes out of. So it makes us poorer. And we know that loss of wealth decreases our affluence. And remember, affluence is one of those climate change drivers. It helps it helps and it hurts, right? Lower affluence means higher population, okay? And that affects climate change, because if there's a higher population, there's more output of CO2. Low affluence also means you don't adapt to newer technologies as fast. So as technologies become more energy efficient, you can't adopt those new technologies because you don't have the money to do so. And also, countries, when they're poor, tend to rely on cheaper energy sources that are really carbon intensive. And so with lower affluence, you can't take advantage of new technologies that are less carbon intensive. So climate change damage can lead to more climate change, which can then lead to more damage. And that's indeed what we're seeing all over the place. So there's a lot of different things to talk about when one wants to talk about current climate change and its effects. There's thousands of different things one could bring up. Probably the most important of which is temperature goes up, right? Extremely large and extremely fast temperature changes is what we can expect. And we know that since the land warms faster than the ocean, that since people live on land, people are going to experience these larger temperature shifts. I don't know if you remember when I was showing you the global temperature anomaly. Remember, it's 1.1, but when we looked at how it was distributed over the hemisphere, we actually saw a 3-degree temperature rise in the northern hemisphere. That was the anomaly, not just 1.1, right? And this is where a lot of people live, right? Most people live on land, and most of the land is north of the equator. So since people are experiencing these larger temperature shifts, that means these extreme temperatures will get more extreme. So if you think back to earlier, when, like, I think back into the 70s when I was young, what the climate used to be like back then, and there were temperatures that probably never occurred back then that now occur now. And those kinds of events will become more frequent, right? Temperatures, you know, the thermometer getting to a height that you normally never have seen before is going to happen each year. And in fact, I think 13 out of the last 15 years have been the hottest year on record. So what does that mean? How can you have 13 years that are the hottest year on record? Well, the first year is the hottest one on record. And then the year after that is hotter. So now it's made the record. And it just keeps going up. 13 out of the last 15 years have been the hottest year on record. And this year already is beat all the charts by a lot and will be the hottest year on record up until now. And we can assume, based on our charts and our predictions, that next year is most likely going to be hotter, and the year after that. Sure, we're going to see some fluctuations, El Nino, La Nina, et cetera, but we know the temperature's going to be climbing. So what does that mean, that the fact that it's going to, so yeah, it's more uncomfortable, but it does mean that some regions of the planet are going to become unlivable. Okay, if the temperature gets too high, people can't survive. Does anybody know what the wet bulb temperature is? What that means? What it means when you say the wet bulb temperature? Okay, so usually that means you wrap a little thing around a thermometer and make sure it's damp, because the moisture makes it feel warmer. Okay, and so you know, a lot of times in temperature forecasts, you'll see, well, this is the temperature, you know, the temperature is going to be 25 degrees today, but it's going to feel like it's 30 degrees. That's because of the humidity, right? Humidity has a really important relationship when it comes to humans and temperature, because for one, we produce a lot of heat. When we're just living our life, eating food, our body generates a lot of heat, which normally dissipates into the surroundings, right? But if the surroundings are just as warm as we are, not much warmer, it's a lot harder to dissipate that heat, because more heat is coming in, right? Energy in versus energy out. So one of the ways that we have evolved is to sweat. We do perspiration. Water appears on our skin. We excrete water on our skin. The water heats up from our body temperature, and it takes a certain amount of energy to turn liquid water into gaseous water, right? Into water vapor. You have to break the different individual hydrogen bonds between water molecules so they're free of each other and they go off in the atmosphere. That takes a lot of energy. And so when you sweat, the heat of your body puts that energy into those water molecules, and then those water molecules break their hydrogen bonds, and then they go off into the atmosphere, taking their heat and energy with them. That's how we cool off. In order for things to, for us to perspire, and that to be effective, that water has to evaporate. Evaporation is slowed if the air itself has a lot more moisture in it. Dry air, stuff evaporates really quickly. It's a lot easier to sweat and cool yourself off by sweating if you're in a really dry place. If you're in a really humid place, that's not the case. And humans can't survive wet bulb temperatures over 35 degrees Celsius. They just can't. You can't get enough heat away from your body, and you'll end up in cardiac arrest, and you'll end up dead. And there's lots of predictions that suggest huge areas of land could exceed the wet bulb temperature of 35 degrees Celsius with 10 C of warming. Now, none of our climate predictions say there's going to be 10 C of warming in the next decade or in the within the next century. But two or three centuries beyond, depending on the climate model. Remember when we looked at the long-term effects of climate change, we could indeed see that kind of warming, which means that humans just couldn't live on the planet, at least the way we are now. And if we burn all the fossil fuels, we could reach this amount in 2 to 3 centuries. So it's something to really, really think about. Already, we have some areas of the Middle East, which at certain times of the year are reaching temperatures which are very deadly to humans. And you've seen probably lots of news reports from different areas around the world of these huge heat domes and where a lot of people end up dying because of heat stroke. The other effect of just temperature is that things like bridges and buildings, okay, they're made for a certain temperature range. So anything when it heats expands. So if you think a bridge made out of steel, If that steel is warmed up, it's going to expand. It's cooled down, it's going to contract. Well, the way these bridges are designed, they expect a certain temperature range. And so it's kind of baked into the pudding when they build it, how much stretching and bending it can tolerate. If you go beyond that, all of a sudden those structures are going to fail. And we've built this into trillions of dollars of infrastructure. Roads can crack due to high temperatures. And we've built a lot of roads in the world, right? Not a lot of them have been built for the temperatures that we expect to see by the year 2100. Just remember, our plus 3 degree temperature anomaly, that's the global average. But we know that there are wild swings up and down. And so we will see days which with much more extreme warm temperatures. And those days may be the days that a bridge or a road or something is destroyed. And once it happens, again, that nonlinearity, it's going to make you poor because it's going to cost a lot of money to fix. So that's just temperature. Another important thing to look at is precipitation. Globally, rainfall will increase by about a few percent per degree of warming. Okay. And remember the additional percent that's added on the top. Remember that nonlinearity. So that's where we start seeing the damage coming from. And I think I've shown this picture to you before. This is climate prediction up until 2100. And so they're looking at the percent change in precipitation since 1980 to 2000, that average. And so if you see blue, that means you're going to have more precipitation. And if you see this brown, it means you're going to have less. And then these are the percentages, goes all the way up to 60% more and 60% less, depending on how dark hued this is. And one of the things this shows us is that it's not going to be evenly distributed all over the world. Okay, there are going to be some areas that get wetter. You know, all these areas in blue here that I've outlined, these areas are getting wetter. In some cases, by as much as 60% additional by the end of, by 2100. In addition to some areas getting wetter, I'd like to draw your attention to this. I may have mentioned this before. This is the intertropical convergence zone. Already, it's the wettest place on Earth. Well, now it'll, I mean, it's raining nearly 90 to 100% of the time it's raining in this intertropical convergence zone. And that area would get the most increase in rain. So wet areas get wetter. Dry areas are going to get dry. So these areas are already dry to begin with. Okay. They're dry right now. And our prediction within the next 80 years is it's going to get more dry. So wet areas get wetter, dry areas get drier. And the other prediction is that more rain is going to fall in the heaviest events. Okay. What do I mean by that? So when it rains, it pours. Here, let's I'm going to bring up this map here. So this is a map from looking at between 1960 and 2016. Okay. And what this is showing is this is of the US. It's just looking at the precipitation falling in the heaviest rain events. So 1% of all rain events, you know, take the top 1%, those we call the heaviest rain events. And the question is, if you look, what were the rain events like back in the late 50s, early 60s versus now, how have they changed in that top 1%? So in this region in blue, 42% more rain fell during the worst events. 27% more here, 55% more in this region, 29 here, not so much up there, 12 here. Now, if you look at this Texas region, Texas has gotten drier over the last 50 years. Same thing with much of the Southwest. This area has gotten much drier. They've been suffering for droughts for about the last 10 years. So how do we see an increase in percentage of rainfall? And I mean, these are serious percentage increases, 10, 12%. Yet it's become more of a desert and drier, and they're in a drought. How do you square that away? So imagine you're in a region that gets a certain amount of rain, whether it's, say, 8 inches of rain per year, typically. Now you go through the process of climate change, and now you're going to get 10 inches of rain a year, but it's not going to fall evenly through the year now. It's just going to fall on like 2 days. And the rest of the days are going to be completely bone dry with no rain at all. And so what you see is more rain falls in the heaviest events, and the heaviest events, these rain events, there's more time in between them. So you get more yearly rainfall, but it rains fewer days. So each one of the days that it does rain, it's going to be a deluge. And if you think about that non-linearity, what that's going to mean, the ground is can only tolerate so much water, absorbing so much water, and then you get flooding. And so rather than spread out that precipitation over a long period of time, it all comes in one day. So temperature, we're certain about that change in impact. Precipitation, we're certain about this change. The physics is clear. We're also certain about sea level change. We know that when ice on land melts, it runs into the ocean, and we know as the ocean heats up, it's going to expand. Those two facts lead to sea level change. And we know if it gets heater, ice is going to melt. And if it's hotter, the ocean's going to expand. And so sea level rose about 20 centimeters since 1900. So that's the effect that we've seen so far. And we're probably going to see about a meter by 2100. And to give you some reference, this is interesting. The last ice age, when it's 4 to 5 degrees cooler, the sea level was 300 feet lower. In the last interglacial, the one that we're in right now, I think the peak was about 2 degrees warmer than pre-industrial levels. And at that time, sea level was 20 feet higher. It's come down a little bit since then because we were starting to approach a new ice age. Remember the little ice age that we had in the Middle Ages? So we can expect this to be going up, possibly by 1 meter by 2100. And again, sea level change is one of those non-linear things. If you think about a city, you know, that's pretty close to the ocean, we always get this variability from the tides. You know, sea level gets high when high tide, gets lower with low tide, and so you get the cyclical going on. But if overall sea level rises, nobody's going to notice until eventually that rises past the level of the city, and then you're going to get that same kind of flooding. And you're going to have to have to abandon the city, relocate, or you're going to have to build infrastructure like seawalls. You're going to have to raise roads. You're going to have pumps to be pumping water out. And so all these responses, again, are expensive. They're going to affect affluence, which is then going to feed into that climate cycle. Another one, which we're certain about and we're already seeing, is ocean acidification. And we've talked about how CO2 dissolves into the ocean in the mixed layer. And when CO2 dissolves in water, you create carbonic acid. And having an increased amount of carbonic acid in the ocean really affects the chemistry of the ocean. And as we'll see here, it can affect coral reefs, crustaceans, really affect a variety of different habitats and biodiversity and how the ecosystem functions. So if we look specifically at coral bleaching, okay, when you have more of carbonic acid, that means you have fewer carbonate ions. And so that makes it difficult for these corals to create their carbonate skeletons. Okay. And that can be very, very problematic for it. So here's a coral reef. And this is after a bleaching event. This is full of life. This is not. So as temperature goes up, so how coral reefs work is they have these calcium carbonate skeletons that provide little holes and little places for a variety of things to live. Specifically, a lot of photosynthetic species. So zooxanthellae live inside these coral reefs. And when temperature goes up, their photosynthesis increases, causing them to release a lot more reactive oxygen species. And in response, since that reactive oxygen is dangerous to the coral, it will expel them. And when it expels them, that's when they lose their color. And it just leaves that calcium carbonate skeleton behind. And now these corals are now really vulnerable to disease and starvation and die off. Not to mention, these zooxanthellae produce about 90% of the energy that the corals need and use. So without them, these things wither and die. And the lower pH, as I mentioned, that also interferes with their calcium carbonate synthesis, so they can't make new stuff. So here's a bleaching event. This is what it looked like before. This is 2 years later. This is an airport reef in Tutuila in American Samoa. This is one of the first reefs to have bleached during what they call the third global bleaching event. And here is, this is a map in 2017. So it's the bleaching event started in 2016 and lasted about 3 years. And you can see here all of the area where you have severe bleaching of corals. Hard coral, by the end of this event, had decreased by about 20%, but killed off about 20% of the coral. Most of this was in the West Indian Ocean, around Kenya, Madagascar, and Tanzania. This was in 2017, okay, 2016 through 2017. It's happening all over the world. This map here shows bleaching events. Again, this is a 2016 map. And now this is the map from this week that's put out by NOAA showing where bleaching is happening now. And so we're in a 7-day bleaching event right now. So this is the effects of climate change now on these corals. And remember, these are habitats for many different species, okay? It's their own ecosystem. And when they can't make their skeletons and they die off, creatures like oysters and clams and plankton, they also are running into these same problems where they can't form these calcium carbonate shells, so they can't survive. This disrupts food chains, okay? So if you don't have the shell-forming organisms, all the organisms which rely on them for food are impacted as well. So one of the examples I like to talk about are coccolithospheres. These are free drifting photosynthetic phytoplankton. They're one of the most abundant phytoplankton. They're calcifying phytoplankton, which means they have these calcium carbonate shells, these little scales that help them float. Very beautiful when you look at them. The ocean is full of them. And they're the basis for a lot of marine food webs. Okay. So coccolithospheres are the primary food source for zooplankton. So zooplankton are these little tiny creatures. They can't manufacture their own food. They feed on the coccolithophores and other phytoplankton. And these things become the main source for a lot of other fish. Okay. Phytoplankton in general are really important. They use CO2 for photosynthesis, right? So they're really important for the CO2 uptake from the mixed layer. And so if we lose a lot of these because of acidification, then that means that the oceans won't be able to take up as much CO2 as they did in the past. So then our climate change predictions in the future change. Okay. With the ones that are not calcium carbonate forming, warming seas also change the timing of their blooms. And so that disrupts food webs, you know, when they're available. And so creatures that live off of this, one example is these pteropods. They're called sea butterflies. Very beautiful creatures. These things feed on zooplankton. Many of them have shells with calcium carbonate, which are also going to fall. They're also an important part of the marine food chain. Salmon like to eat them. Herring like to eat them. Mackerel like to eat them. Some of their preferred foods. And as these populations decline, we're going to see the fish species now lose their food source. And this has like a cascading effect. So seabirds now, if there's fewer fish, now you've got seabirds and seals and even humans who rely on those fish for food, having a problem as well. So beyond the disruption of these food chains, we also get alterations in fish behavior. They now migrate to new areas in search of food. That's going to disrupt fishing, and it's going to have an overall a very large impact on aquaculture and fishing. Let's see, what else did I want to say on this? I know I need to get going. Just remember that our oceans absorb a lot of the CO2 in the atmosphere. Remember in that mixed layer, how much you get from the atmosphere into the oceans. And although phytoplankton is only 2% of the biomass of plant carbon, they do about 30 to 50 billion metric tons annually of carbon fixation. That's about 40% of the total. Okay. And not all of these phytoplankton are, you know, calcium carbonate forming creatures. Some of them aren't affected by that part of acidification, but they're under threat because of warming, because now that's changing how mixing occurs. and the flow of nutrients. And so if we have bad effects on these phytoplankton, then we're going to have bad effects in carbon fixation, which is going to lead back into that cycle of the ocean atmosphere exchange, which could be problematic. On Friday, we'll talk about more effects of climate change. We're going to look at extreme weather some more in detail. Dr. Farous is going to do another lecture on that. And if you haven't, I saw a few people got their flips in. If you haven't got your flip in, make sure to get it in today. This is the one on different climate zones. And then on Friday, I'll issue a new one, and we'll see how that goes. Okay, thanks, everybody. Have a great day, and I'll talk to you soon.
Have a great day, too.